We're going to go ahead now to our County Commission District 2 race, and I'll ask those candidates to come up and take a podium. But while they're doing that, I want to go ahead and through the night, there is another contest that goes on here. It may seem strange to those of you who come from the north, but we elect our mosquito control members. And we have a bunch of them with us tonight, and I'm going to introduce those in seat one, if I could. We have two candidates seeking the seat in seat one. Everybody in the county gets to vote for them. And I think they're both here tonight. Albert Jordan. Albert's all the way in the back. And we have Steve Poches also, and I think Steve is here. Okay, we appreciate that, candidates, and we know how hard it is to run for a race where we don't let you talk. But they are out there campaigning, and pay attention, listen to them. You got a bunch of good candidates out there. Let's move to County Commission District 2. And in this race tonight, the format is going to be that we're going to invite each of the candidates to have a three-minute opening statement. Reporter Mike Wright will then come up, and he will spend 20 minutes asking questions of the candidates, and then we'll have each one of the candidates have a closing statement. There is no incumbent in this race. Ron Kitchen is the Republican candidate. He won the primary, and that gives him the right to face Joey White, who is a no-party candidate, on the ballot. We're going to go ahead just as the election ballot has it, and we're going to let Ron Kitchen begin with a three-minute opening statement.
Thank you. Thanks for being here tonight. It's been a long campaign season. See a lot of familiar faces. I am Ron Kitchen. I don't have the notes. I don't have a speech. I'm going to speak to you from the heart, and hopefully if I say what I say tonight and you believe that, then I'll be your candidate. The main thing I want to get across to you tonight, folks, is that this isn't about so much people. I think myself and Mr. White care about our community. I think we both have served our community. I think we both are family people, and so it's not like somebody is a better person than another person. I think what this really comes down to is that you're hiring people for a job. Citrus County is in a very, very difficult situation right now, and we need help getting us out of the hole that we've been dug into. And I'm asking you to compare my resume, my background, my credentials with Mr. White, and then you decide who you think is the best. And that's really what it comes down to. It doesn't come down to who I think is the best, who the paper, or whatever. And you are educated voters by the fact that you're here tonight hearing what we have to say. So if you came here tonight to hear me tear into Mr. White and tell you what a horrible, nasty person he was, you're going to be disappointed, because that's not going to happen. I'm going to be talking about the issues. I love this format where we can go back and forth and you can compare and contrast candidates, because that's what this is about. It's not about speeches. The two things I would like to bring your attention is I have one of these cards on the back. Do not spend a lot of time on the front with my picture, because that will really turn you off. Turn it around to the back with just some of the listings. And the two things I would like just to point out to you is that I'm a career business person. For the last 26 years, I've been the president and CEO of a company here in Citrus County, and that's what I do. That's how I make my living. That's what I do. And I have a degree in business management from Liberty University. So I do every day what I hope to do on the county commission. I live that life. That's what I do. The other thing I'd like to point out to you is I do have previous public service experience by being the mayor and serving on the city council in Crystal River. So I've had the great privilege of serving in that position. And, you know, I really did get rich off of that. I think I averaged about $3,000 a year the whole time I was doing that. So I don't even think that paid for gas from my boat during the summer vacations, but we didn't do it for the money. We did it because we cared about our community. And so I'm very proud of my service to the city, and that's really what my campaign is all about. So tonight, hopefully, we'll talk about the issues, and you'll hear, you know, you'll get to ask some questions and hear some answers, and hopefully that I'll be your person. So I don't know what my time is, but I'm done, so thank you very much.
Very good. And now we'll hear from candidate Joey White.
Thank you, Jerry. Good evening. I'm Joey White, and I want to represent you on the Board of County Commissioners. As an Army veteran, and if I was elected, I would be the only veteran serving on our board, and an Eagle Scout and a former business owner, I believe I have the experience, education, and leadership skills to facilitate what we all want and need from our government. We need lower tax rates. We need less government. We need economic development, but we need to balance it with protecting the environment in order to make sure that we not only have an affordable place to live, but one where our quality of life is not overrun by destroying our natural resources. I believe we need an independent thinker on the board, one that isn't tied to any good old boy network or special interest. I'm not tied to either side of the current board. I am totally independent. As a member of the Dunellen City Council, I sit on the Transportation Planning Organization, the Community Redevelopment Agency, Main Street Board of Directors, the Rainbow River Advisory Committee, and was liaison to the Police Department and the Public Works Department. And while on Dunellen City Council, I worked with our Public Works Director to secure the largest ever grant for environmental protection in the history of Dunellen. Most recently, I was appointed by our Board of County Commissioners to serve on the Contractors License and Appeals Board. I have a BA in Criminal Justice, and I'm a qualified interior-exterior structural firefighter and an incident commander fire team leader. I also have a black belt in Six Sigma. Six Sigma is a process improvement methodology that's used to gain efficiency, improve qualities, and cut costs in organizations. And I think we can all agree that Citrus County needs that. My opponent has come out and said that he wants to cut the general revenue budget by about 30% and roll back the 30% tax raise that we had. But he hasn't said what services he would cut in order to accomplish that. 4-H, swimming pools, activity centers, the extension agent, animal services, we don't know. He has also stated that he wants to return unused money back to you every year in the form of a tax credit. Cut taxes 30% and have money left over at the end of the year to return to you. Sounds pretty good. But I say that's just using buzzwords, sound bites, and rhetoric with no real intention to actually do any of it. It's a play on your emotions. If he really intended to accomplish any of it, he would have told you how he planned on accomplishing it and what services he would cut to accomplish it. Tonight, I hope to give you some insight as to where I am on various issues, how I plan on lowering tax rates, and at the end of the night, I hope you see that I'm the best candidate, and I ask you to consider Joey White for County Commission.
Does the rebuttal start now?
Okay, thank you. Thank you, candidates. Good start. I'm now going to invite Mike Wright, a reporter with the paper, up to ask questions to the candidates. We're going to do this for about 20 minutes. Mike is a veteran reporter with the Chronicle. He's been here more than 25 years covering county commission and local politics, so he knows the issues pretty well. I did have a caller today, though, call me and tell me, Mike is a really mean person. And because he had called them up and they hung up and Mike called back. That's his job. He's really a nice person, but he can be mean on occasion. But we will invite Mike up.
Thank you for that warm introduction, Jerry. Yeah, I'm Mike Wright. I'm the senior reporter for the Chronicle. I've been covering politics in Citrus County longer than most of you have been born. Well, maybe not. Okay, so here's how we're going to do this. We're going to ask questions for 20 minutes. Now, we do not have a limit on the time for the answer. There's no time limit. I'm asking both candidates to keep it to a minute. I'm going to have you on the honor system, and we're going to hopefully encourage some discussion, some debate about some of the issues. Let's start off with what Mr. White was discussing there regarding taxes. What is your position on cutting taxes, and if your position is to cut taxes, how do you propose doing that? What services or employment or positions do you believe should be cut? We'll start with Mr. Kitchen.
Good. This is what you've heard tonight, folks, is what I call the politics of fear. Every time there's a problem to be solved in Citrus County, the answer is always we're going to raise your taxes, okay? And then every time they talk about cuts, you hear what my opponent said, and that is swimming pools, 4-H, everything is going to go away. Well, did any of that get cut before you had a 30% tax increase? No. Did you ask yourself, where is the $25 million that they took from you? Are you getting it back now that Duke has settled up? No. So what you're going to hear is talk about rhetoric. Ladies and gentlemen, there's citizens of Citrus or Crystal River in this audience right now. He talks about empty rhetoric. If those citizens are here, you were part of the $500,000 that the city of Crystal River sent back to you because we told you we raised your taxes too much. Did we not? Yes, okay, exactly. So it's not empty rhetoric if you have something to back up. And it's always, if I'm going to cut taxes, the only thing I said is the 31% tax increase was not necessary. So all of a sudden, if I cut taxes 30%, we seem to forget, we just take you back to where you were before the quote emergency, right? And the short answer, Mike, is the way we pay for all this is we don't buy things like Meadowcrest, Port Citrus, Ottawa, the Medical Corridor, you name it. And I'll tell you right now, Mr. White, these people are not stupid out here. They're not going to sit up here and listen to you scare them and tell them, if they elect me, I'm going to get rid of the 4-H, the fire department, and everything else, because they know that's not true.
Thanks, Mr. Kitchen. Mr. White?
Sure. Well, I've been on record to say that one of the things we need to do to lower taxes is to rebuild relationships. We're spending a lot of money on lobbyists because we have no relationships with our representatives in Tallahassee. We need to rebuild that. We're spending a lot of money doing double work and overlapping work. We could gain efficiencies if we would work with the City of Inverness and Crystal River better. The City of Inverness has 10 interlocal agreements that they'd like to sign right now, and we're totally ignoring them, and that's costing us a lot of money. As far as the landfill, we just hired 4 people a couple months ago for $86,000 to pick up litter in the county, and we got to provide vehicles for them, we got to provide a supervisor to supervise them, and on and on. Additionally, at the animal services, that budget has went up exponentially the last few years, and conditions are worse than they've ever been. We've never once asked any of the 5 charities that work out there to come to the table and give input on what they would do. I believe if we took one person from each of those 5 charities and formed an advisory board and gave us advice on what needs to be done by the people that have boots on the ground, that we could find a lot of efficiencies out there and have a better animal shelter.
Thanks, Mr. White. One of our audience members did want the question asked directly regarding the 31% tax increase that were, sorry, millage increase of a couple of years ago. Would you roll that tax back to where, roll it back 31%, Mr. White?
Certainly. I think we can do a lot of tax cuts. When we look at spending $50,000 a year on lobbyists, we just spent $92,000 on a study at the landfill. There's a $150,000 study budgeted right now to do a pay study. But when you look at what consultants are costing us, lobbyists, and different studies, we certainly have room to become much more efficient. And I'm certainly for getting rid of and stopping the medical corridor. I don't think anybody believes in a port anymore. I don't think either one of us would have bought Ottawa, and neither one of us were in favor of Meadowcrest. But a lot of those monies come from certain funds, and they have nothing to do with the 31% in the general revenue budget, but certainly we have room to lower that.
Thank you, Mr. White. Mr. Kitchen?
Yeah, I'm sorry, Mike, the question
is, would you roll the tax rate back?
Yeah, absolutely. My thing is being in business, you have to have goals. So you just can't go out and say, we'll see what happens. My goal as a county commissioner is I would want to work with the other 4 commissioners to say, our goal for the first year is to get us back to where we were last year. And that is, look at efficiencies and get back at least the 31%. You notice that the county was in a dire emergency. We were in terrible shape. That's why we had to have the emergency tax increase. And then once they taxed you 31%, then all of a sudden they had money for the extra $3.5 million for Meadowcrest. And so if we were in such dire straits, how come all this money was found? And so that's the problem, is if you don't rein government in, it will not rein itself in. And as you know, Mike, 2 years ago, I presented a line item budget that I did myself that cut $7 million out of the county budget and didn't lay off one single person or cut back one single service. And I proposed to do the same thing. And that is, I would go through the budget with the other commissioners, make it a performance-based budget where people actually have to say, this is what we're going to do. And our goal would be to eliminate a minimum of that 31% tax increase.
Thanks very much. Let's go to another hot button issue, and that's the fire MSBU. Just straight out, how do you feel about the fire MSBU, the fire fee? And we'll start off, Mr. White, how do you feel about it? Would you keep it?
Sure. In regards to the fire service MSBU, I'm open, certainly, definitely open to getting rid of that. But I think what is more realistic is to get rid of the MSTU. If we get rid of the MSBU, the fire services department has never relied 100% on the MSTU. It's always had to be supplemented by general revenue tax dollars. So if you get rid of the MSBU, you have to figure out a way to fund fire services. My goal would be to get rid of the MSTU, go to our public safety officials, and negotiate a 10 to 20% budget decrease, and then tweak the MSBU to make it more affordable for everyone.
Thank you, Mr. White. Mr. Kitchen.
Yes, the answer is, how did we pay for fire services before they hit you with the MSBU? You know, they act like that's the only way to solve things is with another tax. And it's very simple. And again, without using all the initials, which I don't know if everybody understands them, the MSBU is supposed to be for equipment. The MSTU is supposed to be for salaries. The reason they needed the extra money for equipment is they didn't plan to buy equipment. What government is supposed to do is they're supposed to have a renewal and placement schedule. If you have a fire truck that lasts 10 years and it costs $1 million, you're supposed to put away $100,000 a year for 10 years, so when your truck needs replaced, you have the money. Well, guess what the county did? They took all that money and spent it to balance the budget so they didn't have to come back to you and keep asking for tax increases while they kept spending. So the MSBU is not needed if we do the other things I'm talking about. If we go back, live within our means, and don't spend money on wasteful special interest projects, we can fund the core needs of government, which are fire service. And if we operate the way a business and a government should and have a renewal and replacement record, we don't get this all surprise. All of a sudden, we have to replace $6 million worth of equipment that we didn't know about. And that's the problem, folks, is we don't have accountability and efficiency in government. And the answer is always you. We always go back to you and say, we need more money. And that's what I'm saying has to stop.
What about, should the sheriff continue running the fire service, or would you have it come back to the county commission?
Well, I think that needs to be looked at, Mike, because if you remember, the reason the fire service was given to the sheriff, everyone in the audience, raise your hand if you remember this, the reason the fire service was given to the sheriff was that there was going to be no tax increase. Does everybody remember that? Okay, right. So, everybody said, oh, we have to give it to the sheriff because we're going to save money. There'll be no tax increase. And we give it to the sheriff, and we get this enormous MSBU. And if I could, just for clarification, they always do this, folks. They tell you, oh, it's only $54 a house. Well, for you, if you're an individual, it was. Businesses in Citrus County pay by the square foot, okay? So these businesses in our county are getting hammered with this tax, and yet the county commissioners go out and say, we're business friendly, we're trying to attack business, and we're driving our very businesses out of the county with these crazy taxes.
Thank you, Mr. Kitchen. Mr. White?
Again, I think we need to do a business analysis, see what's justified, what can be done, what actually would be more efficient, whether it's the sheriff running it or the county. And there are problems with the MSBU. We need to look at that and see if it's really needed and how we would tweak it to make it more affordable for everyone. I can tell you that I have a family member that owns a piece of 700 acres, and their total MSBU fees with houses, barns, cell towers, and everything is only $120. There are people in this MSBU that are getting by where others are footing the bill. And it totally needs to be looked at, the whole entire MSBU, MSTU, and who runs the fire services.
Thank you. Mr. White, I was at a forum a few weeks ago, and I heard you talk about this MSBU and suggest that Mr. Kitchen's plan of cutting the taxes or the fees could be detrimental to the fire departments themselves. You want to elaborate that a little bit?
Well, Mr. Kitchen has advocated getting rid of the fire services MSBU totally, and he hasn't said how he would fund the rest because it will not survive on the MSTU alone. So that would represent a 40% cut to the fire services budget as it is right now. I don't believe that you can cut the budget 40% and survive. You would have to have firehouse closures, whether it's Sugar Mill Woods or Kensington or whatever. And I believe that giving them a 40% budget cut is putting a price on life, and I think that's wrong.
Mr. Kitchen?
Yeah, I don't recall anybody saying that firemen died before last year when the 40% increase went into effect. And I keep coming back to my argument, folks. This is the fear thing. We raised your taxes 40% because we needed to buy more equipment. We didn't actually, remember, has anybody seen how much is going to be bought? Has anybody seen how your MSBU is being spent? Okay, but guess what? If anybody would have the absurd idea of not taxing you and giving it back to you, oh, it's a 40% cut. And I keep coming back. I've already identified. I don't think Mr. White is paying attention. I've been out on the campaign trail a long time. I've already identified for you where this money is going to come from, and that is all the other wasteful spending we're doing. And again, all the things he mentions are good things, but we have to find millions of dollars, folks. We're not talking $50,000 here. Yeah, all that adds up, but we need to find millions of dollars, and it's out there. I mean, I've already demonstrated that to you. And one thing I hope you hear tonight is I have a plan. I've studied it. I've done the homework. I've done this before, and I've done it all my life in business. I'm not just saying I have an idea and I want to get out and negotiate and talk to people about some of these ideas. You need somebody on the 18th of November that can hit the ground running and make things happen that day, not get out and study things and negotiate with people. And I think that's the issue. Mr. White keeps saying, well, I understand my opponent's going to cut it 40%, but he doesn't say my opponent's against the 40% increase that was levied on you and he wants to bring it back to where it was. So I always come back with the reverse argument. If my proposal is going to make you unsafe, which is always what they tell you, right? If we don't raise your taxes, you're going to be unsafe. Then how come they weren't unsafe before the 40% increase? So.
Thank you, Mr. Kitchen. You want to come back on that a little bit?
Well, he says I'm not paying attention, but every time you ask him how he's going to supplement the MSTU, because it would definitely need supplemented, it was supplemented before the MSBU was put into effect. He talks about canceling Meadowcrest, canceling the medical corridor and all this. Those are enterprise funds. You can't take gas tax money and supplement fire services. And so I haven't heard how he's going to fund it yet, and I haven't heard the plan.
Mr. Wright?
Yeah, go ahead.
Evidently, he hasn't been paying attention to what the commissioners did, because it appears to me they've taken your money and spent it any place they've wanted to, right? So to sit up here and say, oh, that's, I was in city government for a while, go ask Mr. Gudas. I know very well what an enterprise fund is. And I also know how the county and any other government can go into that enterprise fund and take out what we used to call do-tos. And really what it is their way of stealing out of those enterprise funds for the general fund to fund anything they want. So if they don't want to do it, they tell you, oh no, it's an enterprise fund, we can't touch it. But if they want to use it for something else, go into the county government right now and ask them where all the trust funds are. Okay? Ask them where the animal trust fund is. Ask them where the water quality trust fund and a building expansion trust fund. Ask them where those trust funds are. And then let me hear Mr. White make the argument, oh, no, that's in a special fund. You can't touch that. And I think we all know the answer to that.
Thank you, Mr. Kitchen. Let's talk about 481 for a little bit. Medical corridor, do either one of you support it? Mr. Kitchen?
491 or the medical corridor?
Let's talk about medical corridor first.
Okay, well, here's the problem. 491 started off talking about four-laning 491. Then we got into this very elaborate rezoning, putting in infrastructure, doing the old, let's create something, all the infrastructure out there and all these hospitals and teaching places will come. So my answer is I support the four-laning of 491. I don't support the county taxpayers paying for the infrastructure for some folks who have yet to even show an interest to come to the county.
Thank you, Mr. Kitchen. Mr. White?
Very similar. I support widening of 491. I think we need to do it sooner than later. And the way the county is wanting to do it, I think we need to do it a little bit different. The county is spending millions of dollars on a consultant to try to talk people into swapping their land for drainage rights. Nobody, none of us in this room, I would guess, have any trust in government, and they certainly don't have trust in government that if I give you my property, I'm going to get drainage rights in the future. So I think what we need to do is go ahead and buy the right-of-way, four-lane the road sooner than later, and quit spending millions of dollars on this consultant to try to negotiate land swaps. And I also just favor the widening of the 491 and not the medical corridor.
Thanks very much, gentlemen. Let's go on to economic development. How do you feel about helping the Economic Development Council, funding the Economic Development Council? Is it something you support? Is it something the county should not have anything to do with? Mr. White?
Sure. The county currently funds the Economic Development Council as well as the Chamber, and we have a good relationship with them, and they are doing everything they can to try to privatize and go to a 501c3 charity and live on just private donations. I support that. I'm 100% behind that. I think the way we need to do it is we need to continue a very good working relationship with them as they go private and go off of government funding.
Thank you, Mr. White. Mr. Kitchen.
I'm glad to hear Mr. White is listening to what I've been saying for the last 9 months, because that's what I've been saying. From the very beginning, I said, keep in mind, folks, I'm not anti-anything. I was the former president of the Chamber of Commerce. I'm also the former chairman of the Economic Development Council. So I have background in this. And the only thing I've always said is that these, if you are a Chamber of Commerce member, it's your organization. If you don't have enough interest in your organization to fund it, then why should the government keep you in existence? My answer has always been, if you're a business, whether you you're the chamber or the EDC, and you have to rely on government money to survive, you shouldn't survive. It's just as simple as that. But what is fascinating about this, and let me give you a good example. Let's open up another door here. I went to the EDC barbecue, and again, I've been saying
from 30-second story.
Well, you said you wanted to have some good debate. I just want to
tell you. I want to hear this guy too.
Okay. All right. Well, and in that case, I've answered it. I'm in favor of economic development without taxpayer assistance.
Thank you. So what would you do with the business tax?
Well, the business tax is, and think about this, it's a tax, you're right. It used to be a business license. That money was supposed to go into a fund for infrastructure. So, you know, if company A shows up and they say, we'd like to put our building here, but we need water there. And the citizens of Citrus County didn't want to say, we want to pay for water to go there. That business tax was supposed to be put in one of these funds to pay for the infrastructure to go to that building. And what, again, over the course of the years, is that money has been used for administrative costs, and it's been sucked up, and there's no money left for infrastructure.
Thank you, Mr. Kitchen. Mr. White, any thoughts on the business tax?
Certainly. The chamber came to us and asked us to fill out a questionnaire, and I was the only candidate that filled out that questionnaire. And if you go to the chamber website and pull up that questionnaire, you'll see that I am in favor of getting rid of the business tax altogether. The surrounding counties around us, it went from a business license to a business tax, and they all did away with it, saying it cost more to collect the money than they're making. But Citrus County renamed it to a business registration, and I've lobbied the county commission last year and this year to get rid of it, and I am certainly in favor of totally abolishing it.
Great, thanks very much, gentlemen. You know, I go to a lot of county commission meetings, and every time I go to a county commission meeting, especially lately, there are folks who are there who are animal rights lovers. And I hear a lot of concern about the animal shelter, the way it's run, the condition of it. What can you do to help these folks as far as the animal shelter is concerned, Mr. White?
Sure, I've been on record on social media and different outlets and blog sites, like I said, alluded to earlier. We've never asked the people that have boots on the ground their opinion on how they think it could be fixed or ran more efficiently. The current board sits in an ivory tower and throws money after it, and it continues to get worse and worse. I think we need to take one member of each of the five charities involved in helping our animals and put them on an advisory board with the director and a board member, and let that advisory board tackle the problems that they have that are short-term problems and short-term fixes, and give us advice on a long-term capital plan.
Thank you, Mr. White. Mr. Kitchen?
Yeah, it's the same thing I said 10 months ago. What I said was my wife and I went and toured an animal shelter in Sarasota County because we were told they were the best no-kill shelter in Florida. So we wanted to see, you know, what it's supposed to look like. And we asked questions and we spent the day there. And so I educated myself from the experts on, and the issue is, you know, if you think about the animal shelter, what you want to really do is eliminate the need for the animal shelter, because you would be successful if there's no animals in the shelter. So what we're doing is we're talking about throwing money at fixing something without addressing the problem of why the animals are in there, and that's what the experts talked to me about. I said exactly what Mr. White said, and I've said this in many debates. There's many, many volunteers at the animal shelter that get stifled by county government. They wanted to install fans. They weren't allowed. You know all this. And the county has basically made it miserable for people to help the animals in the shelter. And again, let me throw this out here for you. Why do you think there's a big push to move the animal shelter? The big push is, let's make everybody as miserable as possible there so that they'll want to move the animal shelter out of there, because that animal shelter is in the way of developing that industrial park at the airport. And that's what we come down to.
Thank you, Mr. Kitchen. We got time for one more question. Mm-hmm. And I've heard, Mr. White, you've criticized Mr. Kitchen's time in office, Chris River, as mayor and as city councilman, as being detrimental in some way to becoming on the county commission. I'm kind of wondering why you think that way, and then Mr. Kitchen can give his shot at that.
Sure. Well, I got into this race as an NPA because when I looked at this race, I thought the people of this county wanted change. They wanted the incumbent out of office. When I looked at the race, the strongest challenger to the incumbent has been in office 14 years. So no matter who won the primary, I didn't think the people would get any change at all. So the only alternative was to run as an NPA and run head-to-head to either one of them, whichever one ran. And I still believe that. I still believe that if you want change, 14 years is enough.
Thank you, Mr. White. Mr. Kitchen?
Sure. If you ever, and again, I'm trying to be nice, but if you ever want to hear a disingenuous speech, you just heard one, and that is, Mr. White has run a fill-in-the-blank campaign. Mr. White has personally and publicly stated that the only reason he stayed out of the primary is he knew he couldn't win. He knew he could not win in a head-to-head race with the other four of us, and it was a strategic move to stay out. He fully expected J.J. Kenney to win, and all of his campaign and his rhetoric is built about the incumbent. Have you noticed? So he took J.J. out, erased that, and filled it in with Ron, and that's what his campaign is. And quite frankly, folks, you cannot look, and first, remember, he told everybody I was in office 16 years, so the very first thing he told people was untrue. Now it's 14 years, and again, keep in mind, I'm sure a lot of you volunteer in your evenings and do stuff, and that's really what this job was. It was important work. We loved it. But I'm not going to apologize for being the mayor of Crystal River. I loved it. The people were wonderful, and it was a great experience for me. And, you know, yet, and this is where I think you really have to look at it, and it's just pure honesty, and I said this the other night, Mr. White has called me a career politician, but yet he's run for virtually every office, you know, if you go back and look at his record. So he's wanted to be a career politician, if that's what you want to say.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kitchen.
Well, yeah, okay, Mike. All right,
so. And we're going to bring the boss man back up for the 1 minute closing. Each candidate gets 1 minute to close, and we start with Mr. Kitchen.
Well, folks, again, it comes down to, you know, I've been called the incumbent. I've been told I'm just like the incumbent. Well, what you need to realize is the people, the very few people that monetarily back the incumbent is backing my opponent, okay? So if I'm just like the incumbent, why are the people that backed him now backing my opponent? But it doesn't come down to that. There's nothing wrong with who backs who and who's for what. After all this is said and done, hopefully tonight you say, we got to hire somebody to fix the problems in Citrus County. We need it done quickly, and I think that is the person to do it. And that's all I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to not pay attention to a lot of what we said in the sound bites, but that you would just look at our background, our resumes. My phone number is on my card. That's my cell phone. Call me direct. Any question you have, I'd appreciate your vote on November 4th. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Kitchen. Mr. White?
Thank you. Well, I hope I've provided some insight on how I want to lower your tax rates and make this a better place to live. Of course, if you want further information, I certainly encourage you to contact me. My opponent wants you to focus on his resume, and if I had his voting history and history of leadership, I would want you to focus on a resume as well. There's an old saying that you cannot fix a problem with the same people who created it. As my opponent is a career politician of 14 years, I believe he has helped create our problems and is part of the reason we are where we are. 14 years is enough. Just ask yourself this question. During his 14 years of leadership, has the city of Crystal River set the example of where we want this county to go? Is the city of Crystal River the pinnacle of the county? If the answer to that question is no, then you have to vote for Joey White. Thank you.
Thanks very much, gentlemen.
Thank you, Mike.